captivate our attention, Lord, by your beauty and your glory, your kindness, your goodness, Lord. There is so much about you that absolutely blows our minds, Father.
Oh, Father, we do just look forward to that day, Lord. We're before your throne and in your very presence, hearing the millions of angels sing, Lord, how worthy you are. Lord, we just rejoice in all that you've given us. We do look forward to that day. Lord, until that day comes, help us to remember that you are sovereign, that you are Lord over all things in this world and in our life. Father, just help us to remember all that you've done for us. Lord, we do thank you for this time this morning. Thank you that you've brought us together. We just pray that your Spirit would be at work in this place, Lord, that we would leave this place knowing you better than when we came here this morning. Thank you again for this time, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning again. Won't y'all read with me from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 18 this morning. If you're wondering what God's will is for your life, you're in luck this morning because I'm going to tell you exactly what it is. Let's read together starting in verse 16. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Amen. Let's greet each other this morning.
Good morning again. While y'all are getting situated and stirring your coffee and all right. Well, hey, let me share a few things that are going on before we get underway. Coming up this week, our midweek fellowship on Wednesday nights at the Martinez in West Haven. We're actually changing the time on that to 7 o'clock. So I apologize that I forgot to switch that in the bulletin, but starting this week, it'll be at 7 o'clock every week as opposed to 6:30. Make it a little easier for a few folks that are coming in from closer to the downtown area. So anyway, we'd love for you to join us on that. We are going to be in Romans, and if you want to read ahead, we got a few verses into chapter 15, so I invite you to read chapter 15, really through the rest of the letter, and we're going to make our way through that over the next week or two and finish the book of Romans. Never too late to join, though, so we encourage you to come on out and fellowship with us on Wednesday nights at the Martinez in West Haven. And then on Thursdays, our weekly outreach at NHC, the nursing home down the road from here. We get a chance to serve those folks every Thursday afternoon at 1:30. So if you'd like to be part of that, certainly pray for us, but if you'd like to plug in and actually serve in that capacity, there's always that opportunity on Thursdays. On the third Sunday of every month, we also go over at 2:30. And then coming up, as we move into the Christmas season, we're also going to likely go over there and spend some time doing some Christmas caroling with the folks, and we've done that over the last number of years. So if you'd like to do that, certainly that's a great time. If you'd like your kids to plug in and do something fun, that's a great, great thing, and the folks there love that. So it's a good time. So we'll get the information about that event when that starts coming closer. And then this coming Friday night, the Women's Fellowship, that's at the Walker's House in Leaper's Fork. That's going to be at 6 o'clock on Friday. And we've not put the address in the bulletin, and we're not going to post it on the website per se, but we will put their home address in our weekly email. So if you're going to go to that, look in the email this week, and you'll find the address for their home in there. It'll be secretly coded. You'll have to have a special ring. It'll be found in a cereal box at Publix. But anyway, so it'll be in the email this week. So it'll be easy to understand. So Yeah, secret Dakota rings are necessary. So, and then this coming Saturday, that's this Friday night. Then Saturday morning, the very next morning, we're going to have our next men's monthly prayer and breakfast. That's going to be at Shoney's on 96. We've done it typically at Cracker Barrel in the past. We're going to go to Shoney's this coming Saturday. That was last week. We were going to do it last week, but we bumped it to this week. So hopefully you guys can make it out. Our next potluck is going to be November 13th. That is a Sunday. It's going to be after our service on November 13th. It's a Thanksgiving themed potluck. So we encourage you to come and enjoy that. And if you'd like to bring a dish or a side or something like that, we'll make sure that we have sign-up sheets out so we have a sense of who's bringing what and we can make sure all of the extra stuff is covered too. You don't have to bring anything. We'd love for you to come anyway. But certainly, we just want you to be there. So, and then I forgot to mention, in terms of the Women's Fellowship too, if you'd like to bring a dessert or something like that, feel free to do that as well. And then Operation Christmas Child, we are underway with that. Some of you have started collecting your boxes and your materials and all that kind of stuff together. You can, if you'd raise your hand, Becca, you can see Becca if you have questions about any of that right up front here. She'll be glad to direct you in the right direction. So that's a great ministry. So I'd love for you to get plugged into that too. Okay. Well, does anybody need a Bible? If so, raise your hand. We'll get one to you. And if not, if we're ready to go, I'll invite you to open your Bibles to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. By the way, this weekend was the marriage conference, the Heart and Hearth of Marriage that was in Dixon. Julie and I got a chance to go on yesterday, actually, and spend the day there. That was really, really wonderful. And we're going to make sure we advertise that each year as it comes up. But that was a great, great time of fellowship with some great teaching from Pastor Sandy down at Calvary Chapel near Atlanta on Stone Mountain. So good stuff. Just wanted to share that with you. Next year when it comes around again, we'll make sure we let you all know again. We'll definitely want to go. So, okay. Well, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, we're going to read verses 1 through 12, and that's going to give us our text for today. So starting in verse 1, Paul says, "Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know that what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he's taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan with all power, signs and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion, that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness." You know, the Bible is a history book. And the amazing thing about the Bible as a history book is that it both gives us history and the course of history as it's already been walked, but it also lays out in great detail the path of history yet to be written. The Bible speaks of, in terms that we would call prophecy, when it talks about events that are yet to come, with such specificity so often in the Bible, we call this prophecy. This is where God is revealing a plan that he is unfolding in space and time among men. And one of those such passages is what we're looking at this morning. Paul's letters, though they're pretty short in length, are actually pretty long in prophetic importance. So we're going to look at some of those things today in this section as Paul briefly describes really the coming of two princes. One is the Prince of Peace, the one who ultimately will bring things and make them right on the earth. The other is a smaller case P prince who at best is going to rally the world around himself, but really, again, at best only has the potential to give a temporary and even a false hope. And so we're going to look at them today as we look through the passage. Notice again verse 1, if you will. "Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him." And then he goes on. Our gathering together to him. The coming of the Lord and our gathering to him. That speaks of the rapture. The idea of him coming to get us. We've spoke about the rapture a couple of times along the way as we've looked at these letters, but for those of you who are unfamiliar, the rapture and the second coming of Christ are two separate events. The rapture of the church is where the church is snatched away out of the earth. We read about this in not only in Paul's writing to the Thessalonians, but also in 1 Corinthians. We see this idea that the bodies that we now have are instantly transformed when he snatches us away and gives us the glorified bodies that we will spend eternity with. The second coming of Christ is where Jesus actually comes and sets foot on the earth. This is where he returns. This is what most of us are most familiar with. The idea of his coming to set things right, his establishing of his millennial kingdom, and then ultimately he'll create a new heavens and a new earth. But the second coming is when he sets foot on the earth. He lands here on terra firma and begins to set things right. Two separate events, and it's important that we distinguish between these two as we look at these ideas in Scripture, because if we don't, we become very confused about what is being spoken of. But here Paul speaks about our gathering together to him. What a glorious thought. If you don't think about that much, I encourage you to. The thought when you will see Jesus face to face, when one day the struggles and trials will be over, when one day you'll take your last breath on earth and you will be invited now to come and be with him very really, very truly, very tangibly. It'll no longer be thinking about Jesus and wondering what it'll be like. Now you'll know. You'll see him. That day is coming. That day is coming. And Paul uses it here as he begins this next thought by reminding them of this truth and saying, "Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come or the day of the Lord had come." We ask you. That sounds so light. It sounds so, hey, by the way, what I'd like you to do is to think about this. No, Paul is saying we urge you. We beseech you is what that word is. It's like saying I beg you. Do not let yourself be troubled in heart or in mind, speaking really of the heart there, but don't be troubled. Don't be shaken. Don't be under distress, emotionally distraught over these things. Don't be frightened or troubled over what you see going around you. He puts that in the light of the fact that Jesus is coming to gather us to himself. And he says, in light of that, do not let yourself be soon shaken or quickly shaken, stressed out, freaked out about all this kind of a thing, which implies that they were. Paul is not speaking to the air. He's speaking to people. He's saying, don't let yourself fall into a condition of being distraught over your circumstances, which is to say that they were. They were shaken. That word shaken there speaks, as you might imagine, of the foundations being rattled. It speaks of a ship on the sea being tossed to and fro. That idea of being unsettled. There are times in life where we feel like maybe our feet are firmly planted in midair and we don't know quite where we're going to land and we don't understand what's going on around us. We're unsure. But Paul reminds them not to let themselves get that way, which is to say that it is possible for us in our circumstances to be reminded of those things that give us solid footing, to remind ourselves of the truths that God has given us that we might stand and that we might stand fast. And Paul is encouraging them to this end. Why was he encouraging them? What were they worried about? They were afraid that the day of the Lord had come. Now, some of the versions, like the King James says, it kind of implies as though it's coming, it's close, it's almost here. The word actually speaks of it being upon them now. They were afraid because their circumstances that were upon them right now, that they were in the midst of the day of the Lord. Why did I mention the rapture before? Because if the day of the Lord has come upon them, part of their fear was they didn't see the rapture. Now you can imagine, as Paul had taught them about the Lord's coming and these ideas of the fact that they'd be snatched away and that the wrrath of God, as he says in 1 Thessalonians 1 and 1 Thessalonians 5, was not something that we as believers are appointed to. For them to be experiencing the kind of circumstances they were and to be as rattled as they were over them, you can imagine the fear. And so Paul begins to speak to them about that. And he says, don't let yourself be troubled. Don't let yourself be shaken. Now, how were they shaken? Why were they so unsettled? Well, Paul says here, he refers to the idea of them being shaken by either spirit or by word or by a letter that purported to be from them. Spirit or word may refer to the idea that someone may have claimed to be speaking on behalf of the Lord and saying it had come. He doesn't clarify specifically what word or what spirit he's referring to there, but it can be implied basically that someone may have spoken presumably on behalf of the Lord and said these things were upon them, and that shook them. Another thing is that they got a letter. They received a letter purporting to be from Paul that said this very thing, and that rattled them. And so Paul was reminding them now of what he has once already. Verse 5 tells us that he has already shared these things with them. Did I not tell you these things? And so what is he asking them to do? To trust in both what God has spoken to them already and to stand by faith in those things. The enemy is always trying to undermine our faith and our confidence in what God has said. As a matter of fact, he's done that from the very beginning. Did God really say? It's interesting that when Paul describes the armor of God, two of those key pieces that he mentions are the shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Okay? The shield of faith is something that is meant to block those fiery darts that the enemy throws. It's meant to stand up against the parries and the thrusts that he brings upon us, those that desire to crush us. We hold up that shield of faith, if you will, to block those things. It's protective armor. It's the kind of thing that's supposed to help keep us safe. Let me put it this way. We talk about weapons of our warfare and that. Let's put it in more practical terms. Suppose, of course, you would never do this because fighting's never a great idea, but suppose you were in a fight. Suppose you're in a fight and you're wrestling with someone and it's just hand-to-hand combat kind of a thing, and all of a sudden the weapon is produced in that fight. Pulls out a knife or a gun or something like that. That now becomes the focus of that battle, doesn't it? Whoever's got the knife or the gun is probably going to win this thing. So suddenly now, when he pulls out that weapon, that becomes the thing you try to stop because that's the deciding factor in this battle. Well, the shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit are among the weapons that God has given us to fight with, and they are key to our success and our victory. That is why we study the Word of God the way we do. That's why we don't just give topical sermons about subjects that I feel comfortable preaching about, as easy as that would be. We don't do that. Why? Because when things come that we need to understand God better, we need to know what He said about a circumstance or something in our lives, we need to know that. We need to understand these things. We need to know the context in which God has spoken so that when we find ourselves in a similar context, we can know what God has to say about it. That's why we don't pick and choose. You know, I'm a big superhero fan, and typically my main man would be Superman. My daughter's representing today, but I'm going to talk about Batman for a minute. Why? Because he's Batman. But Batman's got the utility belt, right? Now, how many of you are fans of the comics or grew up reading Batman, Detective Comics and all that? That's where DC comes from, by the way. A little side bit of info there. But Batman, as he would prepare to go into one various thing or another, oftentimes you would see him in the Bat Cave getting together those things that he needed for the task at hand. He didn't always know exactly what was going to come upon him as he went into these circumstances, but he would typically pick certain things that he would bring with, and those things would come to bear in that specific battle. Well, the Word of God is the ultimate tooling set up for the battle. God has given us the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. It is intended to be used skillfully, like a weapon that is ready for whatever battle is coming our way, that we might be ready to stand and to fight and to move forward. Not to cower and to collapse and to fall back, but to move forward. Okay? God has given us these things. Now we talk about doubting the Word of God. Remember, Paul had told them what was coming. God had spoken through Paul about the circumstances that were to come, which is to say that those words were sure. God's Word is always sure. Now I will grant, they didn't know that that was going to become part of the Bible and that kind of, they didn't know that at the time. But they did know that Paul was an apostle sent by the Lord, commissioned as an apostle of Jesus Christ. And therefore, when Paul was speaking on behalf of the Lord, that was authoritative. Now, I'm not getting on their case, but they had something that any one of us would give our right arm for. I would love to hear Paul tell me what was coming down the road. Now, in some senses, he did. We don't know everything he told them, but what he told them was valuable to them, and it was enough for them to stand. Let me also say this. The subject of the Lord's coming and the events that lead up to it are spoken of in these two short letters, 8 chapters in total between these two letters. Yet 5 times in the first letter, Paul refers to the coming of the Lord in the context of encouraging them, letting them know that this is good news. Jesus is coming. 5 times at the end of each chapter. Paul didn't write chapter markers in that, but as we divide the chapters, we see that at least 5 very clear times, Paul speaks to the idea of Jesus coming, and he wants them to be encouraged in the knowledge that that is coming soon. Paul's intent in explaining these things in 2 Thessalonians is once again to calm their spirits, to give them peace in the midst of their trials and circumstances, in the context of thinking about the fact that Jesus is coming. Now, I'm beating that really hard, aren't I? I want us in our day to think about the fact that Jesus could come at any time. That should speak to us today. That should affect the way we live every day. It should affect how we get up tomorrow morning when we go to school or we go to work or we do whatever we do. It should matter to us, whatever we're going through, in the lens of the coming of Jesus for us to gather us to himself, it looks different. And that's why Paul is saying these things to them, because he wants to comfort them and to calm them in the light of that truth that is going to stand. And so he says, let no one deceive you, verse 3. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition. Let no one deceive you. It's hard to read a passage like that and not be reminded of Jesus' own words in the Olivet Discourse. Matthew 24, we see it also in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, where he speaks to this idea about the second coming, the time surrounding the events of the end of human history as we will know it. And the very first thing, if you remember the scene, they are walking, Jesus is walking with his disciples, and they're walking around the temple area. And the disciples are so impressed at this wonderfully beautiful edifice, the stonework and the large stones that are brought to bear into building this edifice, this temple area. As a matter of fact, when you go to Israel even today, if you can go onto the Temple Mount, one of the stones that was used to support this structure, how many tons upon tons upon tons? But it's like, if I remember correctly, it's like, what was it, like 30 or something feet long? It's like 10 or 15 deep, 8 high. It's just this huge, and it's on top of another one. I mean, it's heavy, it's huge. But this is the kind of stuff that was used to build the temple, huge stones. And so as they walked by with Jesus and they looked at this, they were just amazed by it. And Jesus said, you know, the day is coming when not one stone of this temple is going to be left upon another. And of course, that happened in 70 AD under Titus, when on top of that structure, that foundation, everything on top of it was knocked down. That's another story in itself. But they were so impressed with this. But Jesus said, the day is coming when it's all coming down. And so they asked him, they said, can you tell us what are the signs? When will these things be? And what is the sign of your coming? And the very first thing that Jesus says to them is, see to it that nobody deceive you. Hey, don't be waiting for the temple to come down. Don't be waiting for the wars and rumors of wars and earthquakes and stuff. No, the first and foremost thing to be on your guard against is deception. Again, another reason why we go through the Word of God the way we do. He said, let no one deceive you. As a matter of fact, turn to Matthew 24 for just a moment. Again, I talk about the importance of knowing these passages, but let's turn to them so you can highlight them, dog-ear them, bookmark them, write notes on them. If you're someone who's not accustomed to the idea of writing notes in your Bible because it's a special book, make it more special by writing your notes in it so when you go back and understand it, it finds real application in your heart. Don't be afraid to, don't write the bat symbol in there or anything as your notes today, but underline stuff and get your highlighter pencils out. But Matthew 24, the first gospel in the New Testament, Matthew 24, just looking at a couple of verses. Notice verses 3 through 5, and then we'll look at verse 11. This is a massively awesome study in itself, but just to look at these verses. Now, as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately, saying, tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming of the end of the age? And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many. Verse 11 continues that thought, and many false prophets will rise up and will deceive many. Okay? Deception. We don't think that's a big deal, but when it comes to our knowledge of the Lord, it has an eternal consequence attached to it. That's why it's so important. That's why he makes this such a primary focus of his preaching through this. Now, Paul says in 2 Thessalonians, back in chapter 2, he says, let no one deceive you. In other words, don't be fooled by this idea that this is upon you now, because it's not, and here's why. Because that day will not come unless the falling away comes first and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition. That day will not come, okay? Which immediately sets it in distinction to the rapture. Because now the rapture is an event that happens, and it is rooted in an idea called imminence. the imminent return of Christ, which is to say he could come at any moment. There is nothing contingent upon his coming to snatch us away. It could literally happen before we finish talking about it today. That's imminence. If that scared you, at the end of our message, we're going to give an opportunity for you to come to Christ today so it doesn't have to scare you. It's good news. But it's separate from the second coming. The second coming, there are a number of things that have to happen before Jesus comes and sets foot on the earth. As a matter of fact, once these things begin to unfold, there's like a schedule that begins to happen where you can actually, you know when that's going to happen. It's to the day. I mean, it's amazing. But the rapture is different. So Paul is not speaking about the rapture per se. What he's saying now is the day of the Lord, the wrath of God, the ultimate coming of Christ that it culminates in, these things will not come until. So we're talking about the second coming, the day of the Lord, and all of the events around that. He says these things will not happen until, first off, the falling away comes. Not a falling away. The definite article is there. The falling away. The word there is the apostasy. The word apostasy speaks of rebellion. It speaks of forsaking, as it's translated in Acts 26. It speaks of defection. It speaks of leaving one thing intentionally for another. Now, what is Paul talking about when he says apostasy? In the light of deception. I think he's talking about the very thing that Jesus spoke about in Matthew 24. Beware lest anyone deceive you. Why? Because many will come in my name. Many will even claim to be me. That's deception. What is the apostasy today? Is it in fact happening today? I believe it is. I believe we're in an era and an age right now leading up to the time of Jesus' return where many who are claiming to be Christians and claiming to stand in, and standing in pulpits, claiming to be able to expound on the Word of God, are deceiving people because they don't know God themselves. They're teaching things that ought not be said. They're preaching things that are misleading people and leading them astray. Some years ago, and it still goes on today, but some years ago, there was a whole movement called the Health, Wealth, and Prosperity Gospel. Okay, this is just one example. But there are those that are preaching a gospel where Jesus is not so much a savior as a vending machine. He's not so much you turn to have your sins forgiven as much as he's a self-help program to help you be the best you can be now. And to have your best life now and all that kind of stuff. The Bible knows nothing of that. Don't be deceived. What about those who claim that there is the Holy Spirit is God's active force in the church today or in the world today? The Bible knows nothing of that. The Holy Spirit is the third person of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It's interesting. I read an article recently, like last week, where it said that, I forget the percentage, but it was incredible. It was something like 60% of those who claim to be born again Christians today, when asked about their beliefs, would actually qualify as heretics. The Holy Spirit, God's active force in the world, that is a Jehovah's Witness doctrine. That is not a biblical doctrine. Jesus was God's greatest created being. That is a Mormon belief, a Jehovah's Witness belief. That is not a Christian belief. That is not a biblical belief. But Christians, or purported Christians, will believe these things. Again, why do we go through the Word of God the way we do? So that you will not make that mistake. So that you will not have a wrong understanding of the person and nature of God. Does that matter? Yes, it matters. You don't want to find out how much it matters when it's too late. You want to know that now. You want to walk with them. Not only for the sake of making sure you go to heaven, but you can't have a right relationship with God on earth if you have the wrong God. You know, Paul says in 1 Corinthians, there are many things that are called God, but we know that there is one. That matters. It's not enough to simply believe Jesus-y things. You have to know the person of Christ, and you have to know him in truth for who he is. Not your own ideas and my own ideas. So Paul says the apostasy is coming, the falling away. As a matter of fact, in Acts chapter 20, what did Paul say to the Ephesian elders? But he knows that after his departure, ravenous wolves will come in and not spare the flock. In other words, they will come in and they will teach people things that will lead them astray. And I hate to sound like, you know, I'm like leaning the pulpit forward on this kind of thing, but it's just, I remember at our church in Chicago, there was a couple of guys that came in with the intention of feeding some of the things I just said and trying to lead people out of that church into their own group. We shagged him away. That's a wolf. Get the rock, get the staff, get the sling, get the hook and the crook, and get that thing out of here, man. That's no place in the church. If they want to come and hear the truth and be changed by it, fine. We want everybody. We want every lost sinner in the world, we want them to come here on Sunday morning and hear this. But for people who already claim to have the truth and they're looking to lead people away from the truth into their truth, no, sorry. Come back when you're ready to listen and not teach that. You're not welcome here with that. And that's important that we understand. Paul is warning them, the day is coming when an apostasy will come. Secondly, the man of sin will be revealed, which is to say, at that time, he had not yet been revealed. What was part of their fear and concern? Well, the Caesars of that time were persecuting the church. Ultimately, Paul himself would be beheaded under Gaius. The idea that there is this idea of being persecuted simply for their faith in such vehemence and such violence. When we were in Israel, we saw both amphitheaters and Colosseum. Or I should say we saw the amphitheater, but we talked about the difference between an amphitheater and a Colosseum. The difference between an amphitheater and a Colosseum is 6 feet. The wall that is 6 feet off the ground in a Colosseum that keeps the lions down there and you up here. An amphitheater goes to the ground and you can just walk up and down on the thing. But a Colosseum is built for the sake of making sure the animals stay down there and the people stay up here, except for those who are being thrown to the lions, which at that time were often Christians, simply for their faith. Okay? Because that was happening, they felt that they were living in the time of the tribulation. They thought this is the day of the Lord has come. Look at what's happening to the world around us. And look what's happening to us. And so they were freaked out by that. And Paul had already told them, remember, in 1 Thessalonians, we are not appointed to wrath. Okay? Now for those, just and not to get off subject, but let me just take 1 second to answer the question that often comes up when people question, well, why do Christians today feel like we shouldn't have to suffer hardship like the Christians in the first century did? Or why do we feel like we will escape those kinds of hardships? I don't think we will escape those hardships. I don't think we'll escape difficulties. I don't think we'll escape persecution. I think we'll do our best to try and run away from persecution when it comes sometimes, but we ought not. We ought to stand firm in those things and be willing to stand as a witness as those things come upon us. We're not talking about hard times and difficulties and persecutions. We're talking about God's wrath. That is different. Persecution is what the world does to those who follow Jesus. Wrath is what God does to an unbelieving world who refuses to come. It's God's judgment. And you and I are spared that as believers. If you are a born-again Christian today, you are spared the wrath of God because Jesus wasn't. We are saved by faith, by God's grace, in the person of Christ and his accomplished, finished, efficacious work for us. What he did took our place. He came into this world and took our sin upon himself, the wrath of God in full measure upon him, so that you and I might never have to experience it. We're not saved because we're good enough. We're saved because he was good enough. So that's the difference. Persecution and wrath are two different things. So the man of sin, because all these things were happening, they thought that they were in the midst of the day of the Lord. And Paul says, no, you're not. As a matter of fact, the man of sin has yet to be revealed. But that's one of the indicators of the fact that the day of the Lord will come. Once that man is on the scene, and we'll talk about him here in a moment, once that man is on the scene and those things begin to unfold, then God's wrath will come. But it had not come yet. So he encourages them by saying, no, it looks bad, but it's not what you think it is yet. Now again, verses 3 and 4, and then we're also going to read verses 8 to 12 to talk about the man of sin, who's also known as the Antichrist. The Antichrist, the word anti means against or in place of. And it's important for us to remember that the Antichrist, when he stands up and sticks out his chest against God and against all that is called God, as we'll read here in a moment, we ought not think that he is somehow equal to the Lord. He's not. There's no contest. But he stands in the place of, like Jesus said, many will come in my name saying, I am he. Well, this man will maybe not claim to be Jesus per se, but he will claim to be the one that has come to save the world. And he will demand to be worshipped through it. 1 John chapter 2 tells us, little children, it is the last hour, and you have heard that Antichrist is coming. And even now, many Antichrists have come, by which we know it is the last hour. In other words, John himself recognized, even in his own day, that we were in the last hour. But he said, Antichrist is coming, and even now, many of those, even as Jesus had spoken about, have already gone out into the world. You remember what, again, we just quoted from Matthew. Well, let's look at the description of the Antichrist and his role in prophecy here. First off, he will rise up. I'm just going to quote a few things that kind of set the stage for what we're about to read, because Paul doesn't give an exhaustive teaching on the person of the Antichrist, nor will we do an exhaustive one today. But let me give you something here to wet your whistle, if you will. In Daniel chapter 9 and Revelation 13, Daniel chapter 11 also, we see a number of things that come to explain who this person is. Revelation 13 tells us that he will rise up as a savior from humanity. Matter of fact, turn to Revelation 13. I don't want to just... Maybe I need to slow down enough and make sure that we have time to do this more often, but I want to make sure we turn to these things and you can see them yourselves. We'll read chapter 13. Just look at the first few verses here, or first two verses, really. For the sake of our context today. Chapter 13 of Revelation. Then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having seven heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth was like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. A number of things come to light there. And again, that's a whole thing in itself. But notice this. The Antichrist, the beast, as he's called here, is empowered by the dragon, and he himself, the beast, comes up out of the sea. We are told earlier in Revelation, and we see this analogy in Scripture, the sea speaks of humanity, people of the world. In other words, what John is saying is he is not someone sent from heaven, he is someone who rises from among men. Okay? It is fascinating that the number of the beast, the number that, whether it's literally or somehow digitally with our technology today, the number that all people who are alive in the time the Antichrist takes power will have to have branded into their hand or their forehead is the number 666. Six is often associated with man, which means that this is often implying that what we're talking about here is the ultimate man, the ultimate human being over all other men, is the idea that maybe he's trying to push that idea or something. But it's just a significant number, and we sort of surmise what that might be about. But he is a man who comes from out of the sea of humanity. But he's also empowered by the dragon. The dragon is not the beast, and the beast is not the dragon. The dragon is Satan. We see this throughout the book of Revelation. He is the dragon, and he is the one who empowers this person, the Antichrist, who is the first beast. Later in chapter 13, we see yet another beast. He's called the second beast. Most of us, after looking at his job description, tend to call him the false prophet. He's a religious leader who ultimately rallies the world around the first beast and causes them to worship an image that the beast stands up in his own honor. Now, as we read in 2 Thessalonians, this guy has got a bit of an ego problem. He exalts himself above all that is called God and demands to be worshipped above everything. Well, Revelation 13 gives us some more insight into that. And so that's Revelation 13. He will rise up as a seeming savior, quote-unquote, from humanity, not from heaven, but from among men. Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, tells us that he will appear as a peacemaker and will make a covenant with Israel lasting 7 years. Brief thumbnail sketch. Justin has been teaching Daniel on Sunday mornings when his turn has come up. And when he taught through these passages, you might recall how there are 70 weeks set aside focused on the nation of Israel. Key insight if you are into prophecy or if you want to start learning about prophecy, one of the key things that you should condition yourself to do is to look at Israel, and that will give you some idea of where we are. And by the way, the fact that they are once again in the land speaking Hebrew as their own nation, a distinct nation of Israel for the first time back in the 40s when they came into the land, but after 2,500 years, that tells us that we are getting close. But Daniel says that this Antichrist, when he rises, this leader that will rise, will make a treaty with Israel in this final week of human history, the 70th week. We presume that that treaty will allow them to build their temple. I say that because that will be significant as we continue through 2 Thessalonians. But we presume that he will allow Israel to build their temple, something that, by the way, right now they are making plans to do, and they're waiting for the opportunity to come. Interesting passage in Revelation seems to imply that the newly built temple may be able to stand next to the Dome of the Rock without causing any problems. I find that fascinating. It's amazing. So anyway, when the temple ultimately is built, it will be built. We'll find that out in a moment. But it is presumed the Antichrist will have something to do with giving Israel permission to do that. In other words, he will solve the Middle East problem, seemingly. Something no one has been able to do in all of human history. Since the day that the brothers were fighting, there has been bloodshed till now. But he will have the answer. However, in the midst of that 7-year treaty, he will break the treaty. And he will go into this temple that has now been constructed. He will walk into it and declare himself to be God. To the horror of the Jews, to the shock of the world, but mostly to the world's acceptance, and things will go from there. But he is a peacemaker in Daniel 27. He also becomes a covenant breaker in Daniel chapter 9, verse 27. And then ultimately, though he's initially embraced as Israel's Messiah, he will, after declaring himself to be God and Israel realizes their mistake, they will flee and he will pursue them with a fervor never seen in the history of mankind. And he will seek to utterly wipe them out. You read about this in chapter 12 of Revelation, verses 13 through 17, Zechariah 12, verses 2 and 3. The picture is painted of God's chosen people fleeing for their very existence. We know that the Arab nations around them want to see them pushed into the sea even as we speak. But in that day, there will be a fury against them that has never been seen. I always hesitate to say this because it sounds like I'm making light of it, but I'm not. But it makes World War II seem like nothing by comparison. It will be horrific. But Jesus will come and save them during that event, during that time when they're being pursued. But just to give you a sense of what the Antichrist is known as. Now here, as Paul talks about in 2 Thessalonians, again, we'll look at what it says about him. He is called the man of sin, the son of perdition. He's called the lawless one, the man of sin. In other words, he's the very embodiment of rebellion against a holy God. He is the man of sin. His defining characteristic is that he stands opposed to righteousness as God defines it. He is the man of sin. Secondly, he's the son of perdition. Perdition means destruction. One commentator put it this way, he is destined to doom. Okay, he is lawless. He is against all righteousness. And the world will respect him for his bravado and his power that the devil gives him and all of these things. But remember, though he seems a peacemaker and he seems like the answer to the world's problems, he will not be. He will not be. In fact, he's quite the opposite. He stands for all that God is opposed to, and he's the ultimate example of it. It's interesting that when Israel was first in its infancy as a nation, when God had been leading them through the wilderness and ultimately, you know, out of Egypt, through the wilderness, into the promised land, it wasn't long before, as they looked at the nations around them, that they wanted a king. It was under Samuel, the last of the prophet priests. And as the people came to Samuel and they said, we want a king like the other nations. We want a man to rule over us like the other nations. It broke Samuel's heart. He said, do you realize what you're asking for? And he tried to stop them, but the Lord said, they're not really an offense to you, they're an offense to me. They're actually standing against me in this. And God gave them what they were looking for. Somebody tall, dark, and handsome, as it were. Saul, who stood head and shoulders above the others, good-looking guy with dark hair. He was the guy. What was he really? He was a picture of them. Well, it's significant, not that they were tall, dark, and handsome, but they looked at him as like, this is what we want to be. This is an example. This is the guy we want out there representing us. But when the Antichrist comes, and if you ask various, you know, Jewish people today that have a hand in sort of like things like the temple, or they're knowledgeable about the condition of the nation, and you read some of these interviews, the question comes up, well, how will you know when Messiah comes? How will you recognize him when he comes? Because remember, he came once already, but he was rejected. How will you recognize him when he comes? And one of the key answers that you find is that they agree that he will allow them to build their temple. That's a key thing. He will allow us to build our temple. And when you look at the plans that exist for the temple now, and you can actually see video of like sort of schematics of what it's going to look like and a picture of what they're intending to build, they're saying it's not just a temple for Israel, it's a temple for all the world. I mean, there's a mindset that is forming through there. Not everybody agrees with it. I'm not saying that, but Israel is blinded for a time until the fullness of the Gentiles comes in. They don't realize what's going on. And one day, It's all going to be unveiled, and it's a terrible, terrible thing. This is why we want to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We want to pray for our Jewish friends. We want to pray and pray that they come to know their Messiah. We want them to know Jesus. So, he opposes, as we go on about the Antichrist, it goes on to say in verse 4, he opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or is worshipped. Okay? Many things can constitute a god, smaller case g. It can be a religious entity, as there's many religions around the world. It can also be a thing. It can be an ambition. It can be a person. It can be something you want in your life that is the all-consuming passion of your life. Whatever it is that is on the throne of your heart is your God. Let's put it that way. You know, football season has started. Some of you guys are spending your Saturdays in worship. Maybe it's UT. Maybe it's whatever it might be. Maybe it's Bama or something, you know, or... But whatever the thing is, and I did pick on the guys because I am one, but it's, you know, I was actually going to joke. I didn't study a lot this week because there was a lot of great baseball on for a Chicago fan. I'm kidding, though. I really did. But I did set a little bit of time yesterday to watch a few innings of the game. So it was awesome. First time in 70 years, man. 71 years. Come on. But anyway. So, but whatever is on the throne of your heart is what you worship. It's your God, okay? If Jesus is not the all-consuming passion of your life, what is? The answer to that question is the answer to the question, what is your God? So many things can be called God. And this guy doesn't just want to be the top of all religions, and he's got a false prophet that helps him garner the worship of all the people, but literally, like the Caesars of the time Paul was writing, whatever you worship, I need to be worshipped above those things. The problem with the Christians in Rome's eyes was not that they worshipped Jesus, but that they wouldn't worship Caesar. The problem with the Antichrist, it probably won't matter that people have other things that they love, but as long as they love him first, as long as they worship him on top of all other things. So he exalts himself above all that is called God, and he opposes God. Again, he is the very opposition, he's the personification of all that is against God's righteousness. Secondly, it goes on to say that he goes then, in verse 4, he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. He sits in the temple. Now, the temple was standing when this letter was written, then it was destroyed in 70 AD, and then... nothing, right? There is no temple today. However, if he's going to sit in the temple, what does that tell us? It's got to be a temple. Okay, that's what we've been talking about. It's like it's important that we understand that though one does not exist today, there will be one before Jesus returns. Matter of fact, there will be one during the time of the Antichrist because he's going to sit in that throne and declare himself in that place to be God. He will desecrate the temple by doing that very thing. Again, Jesus spoke of this in Matthew 24:15. He talked about, you know, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet. And then he adds this little caveat. Those of you who read, let the reader understand. Okay? So if you don't want to understand that, don't commit yourself by reading that passage, although I might just quoted it to you, so maybe it's too late. But understand these things. These are not just peripheral things. These are central to what is coming in human history. Now we'll talk, you know, we'll talk about that, but this is what this stuff is all about. Next, in verse 9, jumping ahead, it says that his coming is in accordance with the working of Satan. As we read in Revelation 13, he is given power and authority by Satan himself. Okay, later in that same chapter in Revelation that we read, it goes on to talk about some of the lying signs and wonders, one in particular. An assassination attempt is made upon him where he either is or at least appears to be dead and then rises from the dead. Okay? And then everybody looks at this man who has risen from the dead. Someone tried to kill him, but he came back and he's alive. And they say, who can make war with the beast? Who is like our guy? Not like who's like our God. Who's like our guy? This is the guy. He's coming as in accordance with the working of Satan. And notice the parallel, by the way. Within the triune nature of God, there's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Within the attempted trinity of the devil, there is dragon, first and second beast. There is dragon, antichrist, and false prophet. You know, Satan is such a counterfeiter. But to the world, they will not recognize this. Lastly, about him, is deception will impact those who did not love the truth. Notice again what it says here as we get to the end of verse 9. with all power, signs, and lying wonders, verse 10, and with all unrighteous deception, among those who perish because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. His deception will impact all of those who did not love the truth. Okay? Not that they didn't know the truth. They didn't love the truth. They didn't embrace the truth. They didn't respond to the truth. It doesn't mean they didn't hear it. It doesn't mean that they didn't understand some element of it. They didn't love it. They didn't want it. Therefore, God will send them strong delusion that they might believe the lie. Again, definite article is there. The lie. What lie? Well, Paul doesn't say exactly what the lie is, but if it is anything consistent with the devil, it's probably the very same lie that he fed Eve in the garden. God knows that as when you eat of this fruit, you will not surely die, but the day you eat of it, you'll become like God. What is the Antichrist doing? He is showing himself to be God in the temple of God, declaring to be God to all the world. And what will the world do? Maybe try to emulate it. Certainly believe it. But that's the lie, I believe. And God sends them strong delusion that they might believe that. That sounds unfair. Not really. They didn't love the truth. And so therefore, what is God doing? He's simply firming up their convictions, much like he did with Pharaoh in the Old Testament. You know, Pharaoh did not want to respond to God's constant pounding of Egypt. Until look at all the things that God did to Pharaoh in Egypt, and he still would not turn. He would turn, then he wouldn't turn. And there's always this interplay of God hardening his heart, but him hardening his own heart. Same thing going on here. God is firming up their position that they are taking against him. They do not love the truth. But rather, what does it say at the end of verse 12? Instead, they had pleasure in unrighteousness. Okay? This is not speaking of just some light practices. This is speaking of the condition of a heart that is unredeemed and will not be redeemed. It's interesting that Jesus describes hell as a place created for the devil and his angels. However, those who did not believe, again, not that they didn't know, they didn't believe the truth, but rather found their pleasure in unrighteousness. Sadly, tragically, horrifically, they will not only become inheritors, but inhabitors of that place that was created for the devil and his angels. Why? Because that's who they chose to follow. When we follow Jesus, we go where Jesus goes. When we follow the devil, we go where the devil goes. I mean, I don't mean to sound simplistic about it, but it is just that simple. And that's a choice that we make. Now, we've talked about the Antichrist. We've talked about Paul's desire to encourage them. So let's come back around to that idea, because we didn't look at verses 6 through 8, and we'll do that here for just a moment in these few moments we have together. Notice in verses 6 through 8 what Paul says, right in the heart of this discussion of the Antichrist. And now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he's taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. The Antichrist is being restrained from being shown. Now, I happen to believe he's on the scene somewhere today. You may or may not believe that. You may think I'm crazy for believing that. I don't know. But I think he's alive. I don't think the Antichrist, he doesn't come from heaven and just show up on earth. He comes from among men, which means he's got to be born. He's got to go through a history. He's probably politically involved at some point. He shows up. I would imagine his rise will be very similar to Hitler's in some way. He'll be sort of embraced by people because the world's going to be in such a condition where they're willing to give up what is right or what is what is best for what is safe. It's probably no accident that the kind of insecurity that all of mankind feels right now in the midst of terrorism and in the midst of all of these things, where a dirty bomb could go off in Nashville this afternoon, I'm not trying to sound all shock value-ish, but it's just, that's the world we live in. That is the world we live in. I'm sure it's connected to the idea that at some point the Antichrist will rise to power and everybody will rally around because he will make them feel safe. He'll have answers. He'll solve the biggest problems. Everybody will rally around him. Religions will lay down their arms against one another and come to worship him. The world is being conditioned for that. Okay? So when it comes, the reason it hasn't come yet, in part, is because there is a restraining taking place from us getting to that point. As a matter of fact, if he were ready to go, he wouldn't be able to come into power until the restrainer is taken out of the way. And that's what Paul is saying. Once the restrainer is taken out of the way, then the man of sin can be revealed. Until then, he can't. But once the restrainer is removed, then he can. So the question, of course, is who or what is the restrainer? Paul, why didn't you tell us that? Now you know what is restraining. I don't. Tell me. Well, they all knew, right? I mean, read it's kind of funny. It's like, you know, there's a great scene in a movie where this guy is getting ready to do this really important thing, and he's being coached by somebody. Now do this. Now stand straight up. No, don't look too hard, or they'll know you're not telling the truth. No, don't slouch because you look like this. And always make sure, no matter what happens, that you. And then he gets distracted and he walks away, and the guy's like, "Don't what?" You know, it's like the one thing I need to know that's crucial to the whole thing. Paul doesn't tell us. You know what's restraining you, Thessalonians, you. Not anybody after that. So we have to sort of put together who it might be or what it might be. And there are a couple of different ideas about that, but I will make no secret of the fact that I am of the belief that what Paul is referring to there, who Paul is referring to there, I think who and what are both effective here, because the who, I think, is the Holy Spirit. The what is the Holy Spirit's influence to the church in the world. I'm of the belief that what Paul is referring to here is the Holy Spirit working in the church, in the world. And here's one of the reasons why I think this. If the Antichrist showed up on the scene tomorrow, if all of a sudden tomorrow you turned on Fox News or CNN or whatever your preferred news station is, and all of a sudden you saw a guy sitting at a table signing a peace treaty with Israel that was going to allow them unheard of freedom, safety, all these kinds of things. Again, maybe to build the temple and all this kind of thing. If you saw a guy sitting there signing that peace treaty and you started, you know, that would be a huge thing, right? But if that happened, what would you do? It's the Antichrist. Look what's happening. He's signing the peace treaty. The temple's getting built. And all this. Look what's happening. Uh-oh, wait a minute. Why are we still here? You know, but if we were still here, we'd point him out, wouldn't we? That's one of the reasons why I believe in a preacher rapture and all this, is because I think that we will recognize the Antichrist. If we were here, we'd know him. Now, granted, Christians are being marginalized all over the world, but there's too many of us to not make some waves about this guy. That's the guy. Don't sign that. You know, it's just, you know, it just, we would recognize him. If we're not here, then what's to stop it? What's to say? Now, again, people have different views on this whole thing, but that's the view I hold. I think that when we as a church are raptured out, as a matter of fact, I think the rapture itself is going to be one of the causes for the Antichrist coming to power. Imagine the anarchy that will ensue. I don't know what the number actually is of Christians in the world. They always say there's 1 billion, but they count every group that claims Jesus in it. So let's just say it's even 500 million. Let's say it's 500 million people on earth are Christians. I hope the number is much bigger. But even just suppose it's 500 million. That's maybe almost, you know, almost twice the size of the population of the United States. Imagine that number of people instantly being gone from the earth. Imagine the chaos that comes from cars flying off highways and airplanes falling and stuff that happens not happening anymore and all this, just all that. Then you got to come up with an explanation for that, because it sure wasn't the rapture, because we don't believe in God, and so it must have been aliens or something like that. Whatever, hey, you know what? When you're not willing to believe the truth, anything sounds good. That's why people are evolutionists, by the way, because if I don't believe in God, I have to have an answer for what I can see. And that's the only other possibility, chance. So, if I'm not going to believe in God, now some people will. Some people will. I think when the 144,000 from the 12 tribes of Israel, not the guy who shows up at your door saying he's part of the 144,000, but 144,000, 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes of Israel show up going out into the world and talking about, evangelists, I think for many people, they're going to welcome that. Not everybody will, but some will. Some will know what happened. Some will recognize. Someone may be sitting in this church right now, and when the rapture happens and this stuff all unfolds, you will remember what you heard this morning, and you'll say, "Good Lord, it was true." But at least you'll know. And if you don't know how to get saved, you will, because by the end of the service, we're going to give that opportunity. But if in that moment, one of these 144,000 show up, you're going to be really glad they did. But a lot of people in the world will not, and they will look for any explanation to explain what happened. So I think that the rapture is going to be a key event as this all happens. And I think that we are the, you know, we are representative of the Holy Spirit's working in this world around us. And when he snatches us away, when the restrainer is taken out of the way, then I think these things will come to pass. The man of sin will finally be revealed. But notice what happens when he does. And notice how shortly it is spoken of. Verse 8 again. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. Okay, shows up, gets dealt with. Now there is, he will have a period of time that he's active in the world, but it will be relatively brief in the overall scope of human history. Others will have led longer than him in terms of their tenure. His impact, however, has eternal consequences to it. But notice the certainty with which Paul speaks. When he comes and he's revealed, the one whom the Lord will destroy with the breath, or literally, he will. When you read in Revelation chapter 13 or chapter 19, when Jesus comes, he's portrayed as having this sword coming out of his mouth. Don't think that's really a sword. He's not fighting with a sword coming out of his mouth. That speaks of the word of God. He is literally, by just simply his word, bringing judgment to this world and the brightness of his coming. In other words, this one who at Jesus' return, his glorious return to earth, we will come with him, by the way, as Jude tells us about, when the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints to bring judgment on the ungodly of this ungodly world for their ungodly deeds. The Antichrist is not going to, I mean, he'll rally all his forces against Israel. He'll try to destroy them. Israel will look upon the one whom they've pierced, who's now come to rescue them. And Israel will be saved. And the Antichrist will be destroyed, thrown into the pit with the dragon, with the false prophet. Judgment will begin. The Bema Seat will come and all these things. New heavens, new earth, all of these things. There's so much more to that. But the Antichrist is going to come, and to the world will seem like the greatest savior in the world. But to those of us who know better, he's going to be dealt with. He's going to be finished. It's going to be done. Over the last number of weeks, we have, as we've looked at this letter, even in my study time, I have found myself feeling very driven to point out the importance of the time in which we're living. You know, we think of First and Second Thessalonians. I probably have not said that without flurrying at some point along this entire time. But as we've looked at these two letters, there is an urgency to Paul's writing to the church to live in the light of his return, to live within view of the finish line. And the more time I spend, you know, I already knew what I wanted, you know, kind of the approach I wanted to take to these two books. But the more I spend time in it, the more I feel that sense of urgency on a personal level. I am not an evangelist. I'm not somebody who can walk into Starbucks and cold call somebody at the table with the gospel. That's just not my personality. I mean, I love people. I love to talk. But it's hard for me to just walk up to somebody and say, you know, hey, been saved? You know, I can't do that. But I can have conversations with people. I can throw starters out there. I can do things that will maybe stir up a conversation in which we might begin to talk about these things. And I say that to say this. The times in which we live require us to take them seriously. You know, the Bible says to be sober, not to be somber. That's different. But to be sober, which is to say that we're aware of what's going on around us. We're mindful. You know, we're not blind to it. We're not unclear about what's happening. We're not cloudy in our thinking. We're clear-minded. And so I found myself, and you've no doubt noticed this, you know, as we've come to the close of a lot of these messages, I've just found myself driven to point out the fact that the people that are around us on a daily basis, they are eternal. And they will literally spend eternity in one of two places when they take their last breath on earth. Literally. I mean, there's no human being that has ever lived that will not live forever somewhere. And when Jesus said that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, I believe he meant the world. You know, when John in 1 John 2:2 said he came not just for our sins, but the sins of the whole world, I think he meant the whole world. I think he meant everybody. I think he meant the guy, you know, the guy in the next cubicle. I think he meant your kids. I think he meant me and you. I think he meant the guy in Africa. I think he meant the guy in India. I think he meant everybody. Now, that doesn't mean everyone's going to get saved, but I think God loves them. And since we don't know who's going to get saved and who's not, I always like to adopt what Dwight Moody said. When asked about election, he said, well, I just simply, my mindset is God save all the elect and then elect some more. You know, but just we don't know who it is. So, but take the mindset and recognize that the things that we do in time have the potential to matter for eternity. Certainly, it mattered in my life when these guys shared their faith with me. What if they didn't? I mean, we can get the whole election thing, whatever, but it's just the fact that they did meant that I came to Christ at that time. And my coming to Christ at that time, 25 years ago, meant that I started on a journey with Jesus that led me here to talk to you today. A lot of water's gone under the bridge. But I'll tell you what, I think my life counted for something forever, which is why we do this. It's not just so we can sit comfortably in a church on Sunday. It's so that we can be active about the business that God has called us to. And as we look at these things, here's the good news about just about every single thing we talked about today. You and I will watch this from the bleachers. You and I will not be here when these things come about, I believe. And if we are, then I guess I won't be a pre-trib guy anymore. It won't shake my faith in Christ. It'll just shake my understanding of when the rapture happens. But when these things come to pass, and if we're watching them, and the time for our work is done, and we're watching it, that'll be a glorious time to be in heaven with God and all these things. But the time to work is now. This is the time that we go out into the harvest fields that are white for harvest. You know, I'll just leave it there with that. But, you know, the good news for you and I is that we don't look for the Antichrist. We look for Jesus Christ. We're looking for him to come and to pull us out of this world and to take us home. Let's just make it our heart's desire. Let's make our heart beats like God's does when it comes to the person next to us, as we pray for them, as we share our faith, because you might be able to go arm in arm with them when he comes. What a glorious thought that is, huh? Well, let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for your word. And the instruction you give us, Lord, is hopefully not just something that stays in our minds, but we do pray that you'd help it to filter down into our hearts, that, Lord, we'd recognize the excitement of the things that are coming. It's exciting, but it's also going to be a devastating time. It's hard to read the book of Revelation or passages like this, even these brief passages, and not recognize the condition of the world in the days right before your coming are going to be terrible. They're going to be difficult. They're going to be the easiest part of them is that everybody's going to be deceived. But one day when your judgment comes, it's going to be difficult for everybody. And it's amazing to think that during that time of you judging the world as you're pouring out your wrath on it, that there are still people who will still fight and not come to believe, but they will still curse you even as they're being judged. The depravity of man's heart is truly a staggering thing. But there go we, but by your grace. Every one of us was hard-headed and hard-hearted before you eventually broke down the walls that we had formed around our hearts. And so, Father, we thank you for your tenacity in reaching us. And we pray that you would share a little bit of that tenacity with us as we view those around us. Lord, which one of us wouldn't love to look around heaven and see a handful of people that we had something to do with you leading them to Christ? But Father, we just thank you that you loved us. And now we pray that you'd send us with the good news, the gospel, that Jesus came into this world to save us from all these things, to protect us, to preserve us, to carry us away from these things so that we don't have to face that judgment. We don't face judgment because Jesus took it all upon himself. He went to the cross and he died for my sins and everyone in this room's sins. And he died and made it possible that any sinner on earth could come. And if there are any such in our midst today, I pray that they would hear that good word and want to respond to it now. If that's you, if you understand your need for Jesus, you're understanding that you're a sinner and that you need to be saved, and I want to invite you to pray with me now. This prayer is just one thing. It's just a way to confess and to ask for God's forgiveness and to invite Him into your life in a way where He will lead you for the rest of your days. But these are just words sitting in a chair right now. But they start something. They're the beginning of your walk with Him. And that's what we're inviting you to this morning. So if you're ready to leave the old life behind and to follow Jesus, then I invite you to pray with me now as we close. Heavenly Father, I confess to you that I'm a sinner. I own my sin. It's mine. But I confess it to you because it's what separates me from you. But I thank you that you loved me so much that you sent your Son Jesus into this world to die on the cross, that if I would put my trust in Him, I'd not perish, but have everlasting life. Thank you for that love and that grace and that mercy. And now I pray that as you forgive me for my sins, that you also strengthen me to follow you all of my days, to know you, to walk with you, until one day I see you. Thank you for that hope. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your promises. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with us as we sing a closing song together?
As you go on your way, may he walk with you and guide your ways. May he be overwhelmed in his grace, mercy, and love for you. And let us be spreaders of that as well. In Jesus' name, amen. Love to definitely.